Transit on the seas, the planet's most important means of trade, has become more fraught and undersea infrastructure more vulnerable amid numerous geopolitical and climate-related developments. This is especially the case in the Red Sea today as the conflict in Gaza drags on. I'm Allison Nathan, and this is Goldman Sachs Exchanges. Every month, I speak with investors, policymakers, and academics about the most pressing market-moving issues for our top-of-mind report from Goldman Sachs Research. On this episode, I'll share parts of my conversations with two experts featured in our latest report that breaks down maritime risks today and the threat to global trade. Admiral James Stavridis, a retired four-star U.S. naval officer and former Supreme Allied Commander of NATO, and Tobias Meyer, the CEO of leading logistics firm DHL Group. Admiral Stavridis and I first discuss just how important and fraught the seas are today. Here's our conversation.
Walk us through how control of the oceans really shapes geopolitical power in the world.
Let's start with a British Royal Navy expression, which is the sea is one, meaning that it connects everywhere. And if you look at a globe of the world, only 30% of it is land. 70% is the ocean. And 70%, by the way, of the oxygen you're breathing comes from photosynthesis in the sea. So water defines this planet in so many ways. And to the commercial world, 95% of internationally traded goods go by sea. And that is because of weight, density, low friction. Think of the difference between trucking and training and flying as opposed to gliding across the surface of the sea. The salient thing for us as we look at this network of global trade is that everything I've said so far is good news. Here's the bad news. The bad news is at a variety of places around the globe, we find global choke points. That's the expression people use, and it's pretty appropriate. It's where the funnel narrows down, and all of that shipping on any given day, tens of thousands of merchant ships carrying goods and oil and liquefied natural gas, they all funnel down to a few choke points around the world. Some of those places are relatively benign. The Malacca Strait, which is off Singapore, that connects essentially the Pacific with the Indian Ocean. No prospect there of real military conflict. But as I do this conversation, I'm thinking a lot about a choke point, and that would be the Red Sea and Suez Canal. 15% of the world's shipping passes through those waters, and currently they're under attack by an Iranian-sponsored terrorist group known as the Houthis. So that's a pretty prominent, immediate example of why the oceans really matter.
If you think about the risks that we face today, how does that compare to what we have observed historically?
I've been looking at this for close to 45 years, and I have never seen a higher level of maritime risk, and I'll tell you why. First and foremost, it is the return of great power competition. We sort of thought that would be parked when the Berlin Wall fell, the Soviet Union collapsed. That's well over 20 years ago, of course. And in that period of time, China was not a big factor. But over the last 30, almost 40 years now, China has risen to become a very serious naval power, the second most powerful navy in the world. Largest navy in the world by pure numbers, by the way. China has more warships than the United States does. Russia, for all of its challenges, has continued to finance a very powerful navy. And of course, we're watching today, the Iranians, the North Koreans in particular, I would point to, have fairly capable naval assets. So when you put all that together, it's a moment of high risk geopolitically. And then, unfortunately, I have to add to that, the wave of terrorism that has really been with us since 9/11, so almost 25 years. And we see, for example, these Houthi terrorists operating on the Horn of Africa Google Houthis take down a merchant ship and watch the videos. These folks look like Navy SEALs. They are kitted out. They've got very capable weapon systems, sensors, communications. Their tactics, as I observed them taking down a merchant ship, exactly the way U.S. Navy SEALs would. These are not the Somali pirates of 10 years ago. Houthis are seagoing warriors. And that, alongside the great power competition, is a pretty heady mixture. And final point, I mentioned the Somali pirates. There is piracy that occurs as distinct from terrorism, political activity, and great power competition. There's pure profit-driven piracy. For example, in the Gulf of Guinea on the west coast of Africa has a terrible problem with for-profit private pirates who are taking down ships, stealing the cargo. So for all those reasons, I cannot recall a time in my 40 plus years of looking at this that has more risk to the seagoing community.
The other risk is undersea infrastructure. How concerned are you about the risk to that? And who thinks it's their job to protect that?
Let's start with the basics. A lot of people, if you ask them, what does the internet run on? They would say, oh, it's satellites. It must be. You know, everything bounces around up there. And that's how that email gets from your iPhone to my uncle's iPad in Dublin, Ireland. Nope. 97% of what moves on the internet runs on cables that go under the sea, on the very deepest parts of the seabed. And here's another newsflash. There aren't millions of those. You might think there are at least 100,000, right? Or tens of thousands. Nope. Under 500 cables carry the entire internet. It is a point of immense vulnerability. And it can be attacked at the highest degree of difficulty by vessels, submarines, unmanned vehicles. US has these, Russia has these, China has these, Iran does, North Korea, some capability here, can go down to the bottom of the oceans and destroy those cables, tap into them for intelligence purposes, manipulate them. They can do it in a way that looks like an accident or a failure of material, for example. And then a second point of vulnerability, and a pretty obvious one, is how about on land where those cables come up finally? Those are very significant and not terribly well-defended choke points. So that's a long way of saying I'm very concerned about it. So whose responsibility is it to protect these cables, which obviously run largely through international waters, the high seas on the bottom of the seabed? And the short answer is all of us who want a functioning global economy. So here's what I would recommend as we think about the cables. Think international, meaning what coalitions can we bring together that will protect this critical infrastructure, including the West. But I would say we ought to be talking to the Chinese about this. The Chinese have very high level of interest in protecting that global economy. Even as we have all our difficulties with Russia, we ought to be talking to Russia about this. This is like arms control and nuclear weapons. Everyone has a vested interest in not making those things go off.
But are we seeing that type of cooperation, or is it likely to see that type of cooperation in the current moment?
That's the right question to ask. I'd say in descending order, pretty easy and already happening between US, NATO, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, the West, if you will. That's about 60% of the world's GDP. Here's the key. It has to include China with about 25% of the world's GDP. So if you want to put your finger on a soft, concerning point, it would be where will China land in all of this? I would argue China, which is utterly dependent on both trade and incoming commodities, will want to be part of the global community in positive ways. At times, those relationships will feel a little speed bumpy, but bet on China to be in on this over the long term because they have to be.
That's an interesting take, because when we think about China right now and their aggressiveness in the South China Sea, it feels like a more adversarial relationship.
I think these are two different issues in the context of China, the South China Sea and the global international trade routes. China absolutely needs these big global networks to work for them, to bring raw materials in and to send exports out. But there is a body of water, the South China Sea, which is vast. It's half the size of the continental United States. China claims it as territorial waters. They are continuing to build artificial islands. They're continuing to press against all other territorial claims in the South China Sea, for example, against the Philippines, a treaty ally of the United States. That is a specific problem set. China's claims have been adjudicated in the international courts and rejected. But Allison, that is a manageable discussion between China, United States, and above all, the other nations around the South China Sea, the Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia, Indonesia, etc. So I think we can manage through that challenge. I stand by my case that China has very broad interest in ensuring freedom of the high seas. We haven't injected into this, and we must at this point, the island of Taiwan. If there is a flashpoint and there is a non-negotiable challenge in all this, it would be the red line of Taiwan declaring independence. I don't see that happening, at least in the foreseeable 5 to 10 year future. Taiwan has just had an election. The president-elect, William Lai, is someone who, in my view, is not going to push China's buttons in terms of independence. I think so long as that scenario remains quiet, and I think it will, then I think we have every reason to believe we can pull China into the big effort work.
Okay, interesting. Let me go back to the Red Sea for a moment. You've already talked about the threats that we are experiencing today in the Red Sea. Do you think that the worst, though, is behind us, or how concerned are you about further escalation there, given everything we're observing?
I think the worst is not certainly behind us. I worry about mines, sea mines implanted in the waters of the Red Sea, or God forbid, the Strait of Hormuz by the Iranians, who have tried it in the past. So yes, there are risks, but I'm not overly concerned about a massive escalation. Let me explain. The Houthis have done this occasionally for 10 years. They've popped a missile or sent a drone or circled a ship, but their behavior has spiked as a result of the war in Gaza. That is their cause celeb at the moment. So I think it is very likely that when that situation reduces, which I think will probably come in the 2 to 3 month range, simply because at that point, Israel will have completed its military campaign. The international system will have brought in some kind of peacekeeping force. I think those are likely outcomes, not certainties, of course. I think that will take some of the, no pun intended, some of the fire out of the Houthis. The second reason I don't think it'll continue to go up is because Iran ultimately knows if it continues to go up, the next set of strikes are not going to be against Houthis in Yemen. They're going to be against Iranian infrastructure. I foresee if the Houthis don't bring this thing down, I think it's quite likely the West is going to have to continue to pound Houthi infrastructure in Yemen, but probably send a signal to Iran going after either Iranian shipping, Iranian offshore oil and gas platforms, Iranian intelligence platforms that are embedded in some of those offshore platforms, or at the really dark end of the spectrum, go after the munitions factories themselves in Iran that are building these missiles. We know exactly where these missiles are coming from, and let's hope we don't get there. I don't think we will. I think Iran will tether the Houthis, and over 2 to 3 months, we'll see a reduction in Gaza. The Houthis will then diminish.
Right. Contingent on the Gaza conflict.
100%. 100%.
Understood. Let me go to the other major area that we're focused on. Russia, as you said, still has a very strong navy, and they're building naval bases in the Arctic. How important will that be to maritime trade and to maritime security?
Yeah, great question. I'll come to the Arctic in 1 minute. I just want to make a point about Russia's Black Sea Fleet, which was a very capable military force. About a third of it is now on the bottom of the Black Sea. It's been sunk by the Ukrainians. The Ukrainians don't have a navy. Russia confiscated it or sank it in the opening days of the war. But the Ukrainians have used drones and missiles to sink about a third of the Black Sea Fleet, including, most shockingly, the flagship of the Black Sea Fleet. The aircraft carrier strike cruiser Moskva means Moscow in Russian. So Russia's navy is quite capable, but it's been punched hard in the mouth by the Ukrainians. And that's why grain prices have remained at least somewhat reasonable, because Ukrainian grain is still flowing out of Odessa through the Black Sea to the Arctic. Yes, Russia is investing in the Arctic. And why? It's because of global warming and the melting of the ice cap in the north, as well as the ice shelf in Antarctica. As that ice in the north melts, it opens up resources. It opens up oil, gas, and trade routes, a little bit of fisheries. All that kind of opens up for competition. Who is up around the Arctic Ocean? About half of it, the front porch, is Russia. So they have a highly vested interest. They have by far the longest coastline. Who else is on the Arctic? It's NATO nations. That would be Canada, United States, Denmark, by virtue of Greenland, Iceland, Norway, and Sweden and Finland are both Arctic nations because of islands they have. So you've got Russia on one side and NATO on the other, and the ice melting and resources available. It's a thunderdome. It is a place where conflict is going to be tempting on the side of the Russians. So what NATO is doing to prepare for that, watching Russia build these bases across the Arctic, is training, creating its own systems to operate more effectively up there, putting more intelligence gathering, using the Arctic Council to try and ameliorate some of these tensions. And I'll close with a practical example. U.S. Navy SEALs, who we think of famously, correctly, in the deserts of Iraq, in the mountains of Afghanistan, Navy SEALs have just created a specialized Navy SEAL unit that is going to focus on the Arctic.
Interesting. Okay, very last question. Is naval capacity up for the task of really defending our trade routes and our critical infrastructure?
Yeah, I think that the two words I would give you are stronger together, meaning, yes, the U.S. has a very capable blue water navy that can sail anywhere in the world and does, about 300 ships, including big nuclear-powered aircraft carriers, the quietest nuclear submarines in the world, very capable strike destroyers and cruisers like the ones I commanded. We have a big navy, about 300 major warships. China has 350. Their warships aren't as big. They have far less experience operating them globally. They don't have the system of bases around the world that we do. But as the saying goes, quantity has a quality all its own. So head-to-head match, U.S.-China, pretty close. But on the U.S. side are our allies. The Brits and the French both operate, for example, nuclear-powered submarines with nuclear-tipped ballistic missiles on them. The Italians, the French, the British all have aircraft carriers. As I look to the Pacific, Japan is doubling its defense budget. A lot of that, as is appropriate for an island nation like Japan, will go into the Japanese Navy, which is very capable. South Korea has a good Navy. Australia, small but excellent. Singapore, small but excellent. So when you add up this maritime coalition in the West and you match it up against China, we're in fairly good shape. Where I worry, to conclude this tally, is if China and Russia were to combine, then you've got a lot of capability on that side of the ledger. Again, I don't see the Chinese falling into the Russian orbit. If anything, Russia might find itself in a position of dominance from China, but I think that's decades away.
I then spoke to Tobias Meyer, CEO of DHL Group, for a firsthand perspective on the impacts of this more challenging maritime environment on global commerce and supply chains. Here's what he had to say in our recent conversation.
So you have a front row seat on global commerce today. What are you observing in terms of the biggest disruptions to trade flows today?
The day-to-day often worries very much about the physical disruptions, and I come to that in a minute. But I think what keeps us actually, if you look at a longer period of time, more busy is the regulatory disruptions. We had many years where global trade has become easier, and the WTO for basically two decades in the 90s and early 2000s played a very good role in facilitating multilateral trade agreements, dispute settlement mechanisms, and other elements that have helped global trade. Unfortunately, that is not the case now since 5 to 10 years, where the multilateral perspective has slowed and some people feel it has kind of stalled. And also bilateral trade agreements have come forward rather selectively. Several jurisdictions have established higher hurdles to trade, higher tariffs for reasons of industrial policy. We also have a stronger element of sanctions, which is obviously the flip side of geopolitical tensions, that tools are used that influence trade, and also extraterritorial reach of other regulation. Europe, for instance, is pushing regulation in the area of ESG reporting that has influence on companies operating abroad. So this is, I think, an underappreciated disruption to trade. It creates a lot of complexity, not only for companies like us, but particularly our customers who obviously want to stay compliant to the regulations in different jurisdictions. But this has become significantly more complicated over the last years because the regulation in one jurisdiction isn't necessarily consistent with what another jurisdiction wants to achieve.
Interesting. Let's talk a little bit about physical disruptions, obviously concentrated in the Red Sea. What are you observing in terms of the impact of the Red Sea attacks on maritime transit?
So most goods nowadays are shipped in containers. Companies, investors, and so forth are focused around this containerized trade. So let's focus on that for a minute. And this is actually quite an interesting system because it's not so complicated. You have a certain number of containers at a given point in time. You have a certain number of slots on vessels. Those vessels have a certain range of speeds they can operate in, with a cost curve of going faster being a bit more expensive because of higher fuel burn. And that system can be modeled quite well. Now, why is that relevant? Because those disruptions, the Red Sea, the Suez Canal incident, have a very different impact depending on the balance of the overall system. What we have seen during Corona, when the Ever Given got stuck in the Suez Canal, this only had such a huge impact because the overall system was at the border of stress due to a very tight demand-supply balance. Demand was high, supply in shipping doesn't come by easily. It takes from contracting to delivery, it's typically 3 years at minimum, to build a vessel. So it just takes time for the system to react. And during that inertia phase, if you then have disruptions, they can have a disproportionate impact. Now, zoom into 2024 and the situation in the Red Sea, we have quite a relaxed demand-supply balance because global trade is still quite slow. And shipping lines have ordered quite a number of vessels from the money they earned during the pandemic. So there's a strong pipeline of new build vessels coming in. The fleet is actually quite young, so there isn't much scrapping potential. So that's why currently, even though the extended voyage around the Cape of Good Hope requires several percentage points of global capacity, and global supply is absorbed in that, this overall demand supply balance is relaxed enough to absorb that. So that's why, yes, we see some elevation in rates because obviously the production costs are also increasing if a longer journey needs to be conducted, but it doesn't have that disproportionate element. Now, if 2, 3, 4 of these moderate disruptions happen at the same time, and we still have the situation of the Panama Canal, which also has some impact on the supply-demand balance. So if you have multiple things happening, that can change, but it's much less likely really now to have a severe disruption because, again, the overall demand-supply balance is quite relaxed and will remain relaxed into 25 and 26. That I think is very foreseeable.
But just in terms of the implications, though, as you mentioned, costs of a longer voyage that uses more capacity. Can you give us a ballpark of the cost increase that is still associated with that type of disruption or longer voyage?
The voyage lengthens by depending exactly where you start and where you end in Asia and Europe, let's say 30 to 40%. And that's roughly also the cost increase from the portion on the water. Now, if you have a container that you ship from A to B, you also have the port cost, potential drayage, the trucking cost on the land side. So the end-to-end cost from a hinterland location to a hinterland location might then be 10, 20% higher. Now, obviously, the short-term impact on rates is a bit higher because the circulation of vessel, if you suddenly add 10 days to a string, then obviously in the port in Asia, you will have 10 days where basically no vessel arrives because the one that was supposed to arrive needed 10 days longer. So in that period, you do have some short-term shortage, and that leads to short-term rate spikes, as we have seen over the last 2-3 months, but that will balance out pretty quickly.
Are you seeing other implications of these disruptions in the sense of a higher demand for air freight versus containers? Have you seen a redirection in that sense?
No, we haven't. And it's a bit of a surprise. It doesn't seem to be that great urgency. We don't see that dynamic recovery in global trade as of now. It's very likely that will change as we go through Q2 and into the second half. But currently, it is still pretty soft. And one indicator of that is that this extended voyage on the Asia-Europe trade doesn't translate to much more air freight. The air freight market has more been characterized by demand from Asian e-commerce platforms that have substantial export into a developed economy that has absorbed quite a bit of air freight capacity in the fourth quarter and also into this year. So this is currently the much bigger weight on the demand-supply balance of air freight.
When we think about trade patterns, some people say we hear a lot about deglobalization, but it's not actually happening. We aren't seeing much impact on trade patterns. So it would be useful to hear what you are actually observing in trade patterns.
So definitely globalization has decelerated. We have seen for 3 decades, trade grew at a substantial multiple to global GDP. Particularly in the 1990s, early 2000s, it was a factor of 2, basically for 10 years. That is not the case anymore. Trade is more growing in line with GDP, but it is also cyclical and has always been. Trade contracts stronger in a recessionary environment and expands stronger when the economy grows. So that is also what we have been seeing the last 12 to 18 months. So that is not a surprise either. And it's not proof that the trend would further slow down. It's just what we have been seeing for many economic cycles. But the multiple is not there anymore. So we'll see more growth in line with GDP. The pattern has changed. We do see that strong growth on the Trans-Pacific from China to US clearly has taken a hit on certain commodities, has gone substantially backwards. You could also argue it has been relatively resilient given the amount of tariffs put in. So there you can have 2 perspectives on the matter. It was resilient relative to the increase in hurdles, yet it obviously hasn't grown anymore. What we do see is that people do what we call omnishoring. So it is not really a trend of bringing everything back home or nearshoring, though Mexico has clearly benefited from this new framework, new boundary conditions that geopolitics put upon us. But if you look in Europe, for instance, it's not necessarily coming to Eastern European countries. Also, Southeast Asia plays a strong role. The Middle East plays a strong role, including Turkey. So it is quite differentiated. And region by region, the footprint that companies aim to set up differs quite a bit. It is also not true that really everything leaves China or that China would lose its dominance in manufacturing certain parts and components. What we see mainly shifting so far is manufacturing of the final assembly of goods. A lot of parts and components are still coming from China. So the sourcing of parts and components still happens there. But what people diversify away from is a single uniform setup of their supply chain for the most critical components and for their most important products. So they seek to have alternatives and not a single choking point or a single source, though some people might not recognize that at the second or third level in their supply chain, it flows back together and a critical part still comes from one source in a specific country.
Right. But just to put a fine point on this, are you actually seeing companies implementing changes?
Yeah, we see places like Mexico, also in Southeast Asia, being very crowded. We have sold out, so to say, on the warehousing side in these locations. We made some investments ahead, land purchases, land banking, which enables us to now fill the pipeline relatively quickly. But there is substantial increase in demand in some of those markets that I talked about. So it's real. Now, does it mean the entire supply chain shifts? No, it doesn't. Parts and components might still come from the very same source they came in before, but some parts of that value chain are shifting. So it's not a black or white shift, but there is something happening in the global supply chain of manufacturers.
With a lot at stake for companies, investors, and the world more broadly, we'll keep a close eye on how risks to maritime transit and the impact on trade evolve from here. If you enjoyed the show, we hope you follow us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or Google Podcasts, or wherever you listen to your podcasts, and leave us a rating and comment. And if you'd like to learn more, visit gs.com, where you can find a copy of this report and also sign up for Briefings, a weekly newsletter from Goldman Sachs about trends spanning markets, industries, and the global economy. The opinions and views expressed in this program may not necessarily reflect the institutional views of Goldman Sachs or its affiliates. This program should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part, or disclosed by any recipient to any other person without the express written consent of Goldman Sachs. Each name of a third-party organization mentioned in this program is the property of the company to which it relates, is used here strictly for informational and identification purposes only, and is not used to imply any ownership or license rights between any such company and Goldman Sachs. The content of this program does not constitute a recommendation from any Goldman Sachs entity to the recipient and is provided for informational purposes only. Goldman Sachs is not providing any financial, economic, legal, investment, accounting, or tax advice through this program or to its recipient. Certain information contained in this program constitutes forward-looking statements, and there is no guarantee that these results will be achieved. Goldman Sachs has no obligation to provide updates or changes to the information in this program. Past performance does not guarantee future results, which may vary. Neither Goldman Sachs nor any of its affiliates makes any representation or warranty, express or implied, as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this program and any liability therefore, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed.